Okay, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the monthly meeting of Cochin Ophthalmic Club. Today, the meeting primary focus is on glaucoma. We have a very interesting talk about the micropulse laser diode cyclophotocoagulation from Dr. Murali Adiga from Chennai. And then we also have a panel discussion on choice of drug in a few clinical scenarios in glaucoma. And we have Dr. Abhilash, who will be presenting a few clinical scenarios. And joining us along with Murali in the panel discussion will be Dr. Devan Tuli from Delhi. Dr. Devan is a very active member of the Glaucoma Society of India. And we also will have Dr. Manoj Prathapan in the panel, along with Dr. Abhilash. He will also be part of the panel during the panel discussion about the drugs. So before we start with the program, I would like to introduce Dr. Murali Adiga. Dr. Murali is a very close friend of mine. He is the director and senior consultant of the Swami Eye Clinic in the Chennai Glaucoma Foundation. He also is associated with the MN Eye Hospitals and also the MN College of Optometry. He has been a very prominent figure in the glaucoma circles all over the country. He has given talks all over the country. He is also a very popular speaker outside India. I know that he has given a series of lectures for the Malaysian Glaucoma Society, which the series was actually very, very popular. He has also been the treasurer of the Glaucoma Society of India. He has won numerous awards, including the Top Innovations Award in the All India Ophthalmic Conference in Jaipur. He has got a very long CV. I'm not going to read the entire CV. We'll move on with the talk. I request Dr. Murali to deliver his talk on micropulse diode laser in the management of glaucoma. It's a very interesting topic. Many who really vouch for it feel that it is the answer in many recalcitrant glaucomas. In many glaucomas where there's a lot of, you are using 4 drugs, 5 drugs, a lot of allergies are there. In many situations, this appears to be the answer. Gopal, you want to say something before we start with the program?
Not regarding any of these. We will just go ahead with the program. No problem.
Announcements which is there, we'll have after the program.
Yeah.
We have quite a lot of announcement about the upcoming programs. So I request Dr. Murali to share.
Or should we wait for some more people to join before we do that? Maybe we can.
But the number there of must be people watching less. In Zoom, the numbers is less, but I think
In YouTube there'll be a lot of numbers.
YouTube. Yeah.
Okay. Oh. Let's go forward.
Yeah. Get started. Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Gopal. Thank you, all my friends at the Cochin Ophthalmic Club, and thanks Sai for this invitation. It's always a pleasure to take part either virtually or physically at the Cochin Ophthalmic Club. I think I have been coming and I have been participating in the COC discussions and meetings for quite some time now. And it's always a pleasure to see so much of academic activity, so much of enthusiasm and interest for learning and academics going on. We're all a lazy kind of an ophthalmic society back in Chennai. And unless we are forced to talk, unless we are forced to interact, we generally go to sleep. So it's been really nice to see the Cochin Ophthalmic Club keep it going despite webinar, despite COVID and everything else. So shall I get started, Dr. Gopal? I've started my presentation.
Sure.
Yeah, you can start.
So I'll cut my video so that I think there may be some bandwidth problems. I'll just cut my video as I'm talking. Am I audible and clear? Yeah. So as Sai was pointing out, the micropulse diode laser has promised to be a sort of a game changer in glaucoma management. And we're all quite excited about anything new that comes in, and we're all wondering whether this would really change the way we practice glaucoma in the future and so on. let's see how it has evolved as far as my practice is concerned. And I was one of the people who sort of initially started off with the MicroPulse laser in India. And probably we started about 3 years ago. And as far as ophthalmology is concerned, I think MicroPulse diode laser is not new. And it has been used for retinal photocoagulation. It has been used in trabeculoplasty as well, the MicroPulse laser trabeculoplasty. And now, of course, I'm going to talk today mainly about the MicroPulse cyclophotocoagulation, or reducing the intraocular pressure and the means and the method by which we use the MicroPulse and various aspects of cyclophotocoagulation with respect to glaucoma. So I think very briefly about MicroPulse laser trabeculoplasty. I do SLT quite a bit, the selective laser trabeculoplasty. I don't do MicroPulse laser trabeculoplasty. But there are subtle differences between the MLT, as it is called, the MicroPulse laser trabeculoplasty, and the SLT and the ALT. ALT, I think very few of us do. Most people don't do ALT now. As you can see, the spot size is about 50 microns. The SLT is 400 microns and the MLT is 300 microns. So actually MLT has a smaller spot size to access narrow angles, and it's effective as the SLT, and post-op inflammation is literally very minimal as far as the reaction is concerned. So it's actually a very good option, and does look like it's quite a promising method to lower the intraocular pressure as compared to the SLT. So SLT and MLT look similar. For those of you who do MLT, I think it's definitely a good method to reduce intraocular pressure. This is the MLT for you with an on-off duty cycle, and actually reduces the thermal buildup because of the MicroPulse nature of the laser itself. And therefore, there is no coagulative necrosis as far as the trabecular meshwork is concerned. So much about the MLT. I'm not talking any further about trabeculoplasty. Let's come to cyclodestructive procedures. So we think of destroying the aqueous production or destroying the ciliary body mechanism and ciliary processes. And there are various methods historically, looking at diathermy, we looked at cryotherapy, and some people have even considered ultrasound in certain centers, and also, of course, the lasers. I think this is all a very familiar picture, and you all know how the cyclocryo used to be done for quite some time in our PG days. You place the cryo tip a millimeter or two behind, and then you wait for the ice ball to form, and then you destroy the ciliary process. And this used to be the method of treating and reducing intraocular pressure in intractable glaucomas for a long time, maybe 10 to 20 years ago. Then came the laser and laser cyclophotocoagulation. And historically, for those of you who are students and who would like to know the history of laser cyclophotocoagulation, the mechanism, of course, to reduce the aqueous production by destroying the pigmented ciliary epithelium. And how does it do that? Usually it is done transclearly. And lasers like the Xenon Arc, Ruby laser, NDI, Krypton have all been used in the past, but none has stood the test of time. And since the American Academy's technical report in 2002, which clearly mentions that the diode laser is the way to go because of its lesser energy, better UV absorption by the melanin, and a quicker, greater durability with a portable machine and a lower maintenance cost, I think all of us have actually switched to the diode laser as a method of cyclodestruction as far as laser cyclophotocoagulation is concerned. So this is also very familiar to most institutions. We've been doing this for now almost 10 to 15 years or even longer. And the transscleral diode laser with the G probe, as it is called, is done like this. You administer a block, peribulbar or retrobulbar. These are the settings of the power and the duration. And then the G probe has a fiber optic laser tip, which protrudes about 1.5 millimeters behind the anterior edge of the foot plate, which means that you're delivering the laser about 1.5, 1.2 millimeters behind the limbus, which is where the pars plicata or the ciliary processes are. And it protrudes about 0.7 millimeter with a slight indentation. So you can apply a spot-like method of applying the laser all around, 180 degrees, 270 degrees, depending on the extent of IOP lowering you want. This was how the G-probe and the cyclo laser used to be done. And usually the energy is scaled up to 1500 or even 2000 milliwatts, and a visible and an audible pop is sometimes heard when the laser is being delivered. This would actually mean that it's a UVL micro explosion, the ciliary process is actually going off. So this actually means that the energy is too high. You scale down the energy once you get the pop, and this is how we used to do with the transscleral diode laser with the G probe. This was the continuous wave diode laser. So, but we used to get many complications with the continuous wave diode laser. The cyclodestruction was targeting the pars placata, which I said 1.5 millimeters behind the limbus. Conjunctival burns used to occur. Definitely, you will get iridocyclitis, you will get a flare, you will get cells, you will get postoperative pain and a hyphema, sometimes even hemorrhages into the vitreous. Sometimes I would become very soft and go in for hypotony. And people used to get even thysical eyes. And very, very rarely, a sympathetic ophthalmia has also been reported in the other eye. So this was quite worrisome. And so therefore, we would reserve the continuous wave diode laser cyclodestruction as a method of lowering the intraocular pressure only in end-stage absolute glaucomas, refractory glaucomas, post-PK glaucomas, post-VR surgery glaucomas, when nothing else was working and vision potential was less. So this was the history of the continuous wave diode laser as far as cyclodestruction is concerned. Then now comes in the new micropulse laser cyclophotocoagulation. So this is a new technology and it is used to denature the target tissue, which is the ciliary process and the ciliary body, while minimizing the collateral damage. So this device actually applies a series of short repetitive bursts of energy, which will confine the thermal effect to the absorbing tissue. And it is applied in a sweeping movement, as I can see in the picture. This is not applied in a spot-like application like the previous laser, like the G-probe. This probe is different. And what exactly is this micropulse? I think all of us who do ultrasound, who do laser, and who do phaco, we all know what this micropulse actually means. The continuous wave is directly, you see the laser is being applied throughout the duration in which it is on. Whereas the micropulse actually has a control of the thermal elevation by chopping it up into repetitive short pulses. So we have a duty cycle. So for example, in the micropulse laser, which we use for glaucoma, the cyclo G6 as we call it, the duty cycle is about 31.3%, which means you have the laser on for 0.5 milliseconds and 1.5 milliseconds off. So this is what we mean by micropulsing the diode laser as far as the application is concerned. So if you look at the different types of probe, earlier we used to have this G probe and the application used to be spot wise like this. You can go 180, 270, or very rarely we do 360, but never we do 360. And this is a side view of the probe which is kept. It's about 1.2 millimeters and the probe is kept like this. It is positioned on the limbus and held parallel to the visual axis. This is how the G probe used to be kept. But the MP3 probe is totally different. How we place the probe is kept perpendicular to the surface of the globe. It is kept almost nearly 3.5 millimeters to 4 millimeters behind. It is way behind the pars placata. And the application, that the tip design is in such a way that you actually do a sweeping motion across the superior and the inferior hemispheres. You leave out the 3 o'clock and the 9 o'clock, and this is the so-called MP3 probe. The probe is different, the positioning is different, the laser is different. So the continuous wave TACPC or the continuous wave transscleral cyclophotocoagulation is said to be destructive. As you can see, this is one of Professor Paul Chu's pictures from Singapore in the NUHS. You will find the change and destruction, which is very characteristic of cyclodestruction. There is tissue retraction, there is shrinkage, and definitely we are actually destroying the ciliary body. This is what we mean by continuous wave TACPC. Whereas if we look at the micropulse, the same workers have done this. This is the UBM picture. There is no detectable evidence of tissue damage with the micropulse transscleral cyclophotocoagulation. This does not mean that nothing has happened. This means that at least you don't see it clinically, or you probably don't see it on the UBM pictures and so on. For those who are interested in research and histopathology and so on, these are actually pictures of histological images with the conjunctiva, histological images of the ciliary body muscle, and as well as the PAS formation and so on. It shows that the extent of inflammation between the continuous wave and the micropulse is no different, and statistically not different between continuous wave and the micropulse. But the extent of damage, the extent of PAS formation, and the ciliary muscle is relatively better preserved as far as the micropulse is concerned. So therefore, you probably have a laser which is less destructive than in the past, but probably has a similar effect as far as IOP lowering is concerned. So then how does it actually work? You're keeping it behind the limbus, you're keeping it on the pars plana area. It is postulated that the micropulse CPC actually increases the existing uveal scleral outflow without actually damaging and destroying tissue, and supposed to work somewhat like pilocarpine and increases the outflow, uveal scleral outflow. It also said to shorten the ciliary, longitudinal ciliary muscles, and opens up the Schlemm's canal and the trabecular meshwork spaces, and probably also increases the outflow of a conventional pathway as well. All this is hypothesis. We don't really have any proven mechanism to say this is the way it works. But it is said that this is a strongly believed hypothesis. This is how the MicroPulse CPC is actually working. So I do it in the operation theater, and we administer a peribulbar or a retrobulbar. My favorite is the peribulbar block. It is better not to do a subtenon, because a subtenon can sometimes result in a large subconjunctival hemorrhage and redness and so on. So I would avoid the subtenon as a choice of anesthetic. It is not good to do it in a topical because it is quite painful for the patient sometimes. So therefore, it is better to administer a block. Because you're administering a block, obviously you need an anesthetist to watch by. Like in this day and age of health issues, you probably have monitored anesthetic care in an OT setting. These are my settings which I've been using for quite some time. It's 80 seconds for each hemifield. The energy is about 2000, so 2000 each hemifield. You would try to avoid the 2 o'clock and the 3 o'clock and the 9 o'clock positions where the vessels and the nerves are. So this is probably the best settings. But there are so many variables and various surgeons and various methods of administering this. The power has been described as varying between 1600 to 2500, but the company recommends 2000 for 80 seconds. Some surgeons now have scaled down to 50 seconds depending on how much IOP lowering you want. Some surgeons have gone up to 100 seconds also. But this is actually from surgeon to surgeon, center to center, it can be varied. But generally, you would start off with 2000, 80 seconds per hemisphere. And there's something called as a sweep velocity, as you're sweeping inferiorly and superiorly. So we're going to do 80 seconds. So we'll end up doing about 5 sweeps, approximately 16 seconds per sweep. So this takes a bit of learning to do, and you learn to sweep it slowly and apply a firm pressure, place the probe in the correct location. There is a mark and a notch towards the limbus, which is obvious as you see the probe. The probe position is kept in the way which it has been described. And of course, you need to use a lubricant gel without fail. Because without a lubricant, you will have friction and you tend to damage the conjunctiva. A firm pressure, a good lubricant gel would definitely help you. And the energy administered and delivered to the area of treatment would be better if you have a thick lubricant gel, like something like our visco, any kind of a viscoelastic lubricant is fine. And you can have issues in certain eyes, distorted globes, and particularly in pediatric situations, you have a large globe diameter. What can happen is you cannot assume that the same position of the ciliary process or ciliary body is going to be there. So one method of doing this, what I usually do is when you have a distorted globe anatomy or a child, what you can actually do what is called as a scleral transillumination. Like this, you place a small pen torch like device away and you can actually see the dark area which tells you where the ciliary body is. And therefore, this is actually will correlate in UBM also as an area of where the ciliary process and ciliary body is. This is actually used as an indicator for where you can site your sclerotomies also. So this has been used extensively by retinal surgeons also. So you can start using this whenever you have a doubt about where the ciliary process could be, so that you don't start destroying tissue which is not ciliary process or ciliary body. So this is a one clue as to where you can locate the ciliary process and therefore apply the MP3 probe. So I'll show you a short video of what is actually how it is done. And this is done in the theater, of course, as I already told you. And after administering the block, and be comfortable both for the patient as well as for yourself. It can be done without the microscope, but it's actually more convenient. I usually mark the 3 o'clock and the 9 o'clock, and this is the small notch which is towards the limbus. So you start sweeping it slowly from left to right, and this is how you sweep slowly, approximately about 15 seconds, about 5 sweeps for about 80 seconds, both inferiorly and superiorly. The slow sweeping movement, and most patients are quite comfortable. And where do I do this laser? I think as we have discussed before, cyclodestruction in the past used to be all the intractable glaucomas, absolute glaucomas, painful blind eyes, very, very high pressures and so on. But now the scenario has actually changed. I am showing you examples of people who actually see well. And I usually do it in, say, moderate to advanced glaucomas. Not the mild glaucomas, not as essentially as a primary treatment, can be done for moderate to advanced glaucomas, can be done when you feel that nothing else is working. And for example, I'll show you these 4 scenarios which I have shown in the picture here. The one on the top left is actually an advanced primary angle closure glaucoma with a very, very shallow anterior chamber, very, very high pressures after a YAG PI. Pressures are 32 and 34. And despite three drugs and so on, the patient is extremely unwilling for any incisional surgery. So therefore, we decided to do one eye cyclodestruction with the cyclophotocoagulation with the micropulse. To our surprise, the patient did extremely well in one eye and went on and had the other eye also done. The pressure came down by about 6 to 7 millimeters. The entire medication could not be stopped. But from four drugs, the patient is now on one drug and continues to be on follow-up. This has relieved the surgeon of the dread of having a shallow chamber, the dread of angle closure, and the dread of malignant glaucoma in such a situation. So where we were dreading to do trabeculectomy, you can consider this whenever you think incisional surgery is not possible. The picture one below that is the one of a patient who underwent, one-eyed patient who underwent a phacotrab first. You can see the iridectomy there. It didn't do well despite reviving the bleb. Then went on to do an AGV. The AGV also didn't control the pressure. The pressure still remained high. Then we ended up doing the cyclodestruction in about 270 degrees using the micropulse. And the patient has done very well after the cyclophotocoagulation with the cyclo G6. The patient on the top right is a lady who is actually, as you can see, the dark circles and the hyperemia. Again, on multiple medication, completely intolerant to any kind of medication, doesn't tolerate any drugs. And pressures remain 28 and 30, and slowly glaucoma is progressing and does not want surgery. So this is another situation where I have done the micropulse cyclophotocoagulation. And the picture below on the right is a lady with Boston keratoprosthesis in both eyes. And as you can see, the tarsography in one eye, I opened the tarsography in the right eye. We cannot measure the pressure. We only look at the optic disc and decide that the glaucoma is getting worse in this situation. And if similar will be a post-PK glaucoma. So when you can't do anything else, you can't do a trab here, you can't have medication which is controlling this. This lady actually has stabilized and the pressure seemed to have sort of gotten better with the micropulse cyclophotocoagulation. Some situations where this can be done. Of course, in all the other situations where you are considering the older generation continuous wave and cyclodestruction, you can actually do the micropulse as well. Post laser, you would continue the glaucoma treatment at least a week or two review till the intraocular pressure sort of stabilizes. Then you can slowly start stepping down. But you will find that totally you will not be able to remove all medication. From three drugs and four drugs, you will probably end up with one or two drugs. So it will be something like a qualified success. You will not have a complete success. That is a fact as far as micropulse CPC is concerned. Patients would require oral analgesia for the pain relief. You must monitor the visual acuity and the intraocular pressure, needless to say. And you will require a steroid depending on the extent of inflammation. Cyclopegia, depending on the kind of pain and inflammation that you have. Atropine, homatropine, and so on. Usually, I end up giving dexamethasone or prednisolone, Pretfort for about a week or 10 days, depending on the inflammation. But most patients, I can assure you, are quite comfortable. And you end up stopping the steroid in the 7th to the 10th day. There are multiple problems associated with the micropulse CPC. It is not a fantastic solve-all kind of, is not the wonder cure for glaucoma. People will have pain and redness. There can be a mild fibrin reaction. Your initial learning curve, there will be a fibrin reaction. You will be doing it enthusiastically and you will find there's a short learning curve. Vision loss of 1 to 2 lines is expected. Sometimes it is transient in some patients. In some patients, the vision loss can actually persist. So this has to be informed to the patient. Pupil can sometimes get dilated if you are applying it very firmly and a little closer to the limbus than before. Pupil can become dilated, mid-dilated. An epithelial haze and people with susceptible, say, so-called ocular surface can actually end up with a hazy cornea or a neurotrophic keratitis very rarely. This is said to be a conjunctival inflammation, maybe a goblet cell destruction and so on. Very, very rarely you get hypotonia or choroidal. In my series of about 300, 350 odd eyes now, I had one patient who had a hypotonia and a choroidal, and it was controlled medically. So the incidence of so-called serious complications like hypotonia and choroidals in phthisis is quite rare. And I think it can be safely done in most patients. And some patients users in the north from PGA Chandigarh have reported a case or two of retinal detachment occurring after micropulse CPC. I have not seen any patient and there has been no such report from users in the south, But you should try to avoid areas of thin sclera, the ones which are like severely rheumatoid arthritis, any kind of systemic collagen vascular diseases, areas of blood clots. Blood actually takes up more energy. And recent post-ops, obvious inflammation, all these kind of recent active inflammation, obviously you would avoid doing the cyclophotocoagulation. A lot of literature is available for those who would like to read up. The American Academy, the Journal of Glaucoma, the Survey of Ophthalmology all have articles on the micropulse transscleral CPC. And for those of you who are interested, you can look up the literature. A lot of peer-reviewed literature available on this subject for the last 2-3 years. And I think very useful information, a lot of critical review has also come in. Our first study was actually published as a poster in the ICGS in 2020. And we found it actually a very safe and effective alternative for uncontrolled glaucomas. Definitely reduces the number of topical medication. Our IOP lowering is between 20 to 25% in about 78 to 80% of patients. And you can definitely expect it to be safe. There were no complications, at least in this series of 72 eyes, which we presented last year. And thereafter, actually, we went on to publish our first paper on micropulse TACPC in refractive glaucoma in Indian eyes. This was published in International Ophthalmology this year. And this showed similar results that we didn't really have any serious complications. This was a series of 55 eyes followed up for at least 6 months and so on. This was the initial Indian experience. We are continuing to work on the data and we're continuing to look at various aspects of who it is suitable for and what is the outcomes and long-term effect and so on. And we are continuing to now study it on primary angle closure eyes. This study is actually going on along with the Aravind Eye Hospital in Madurai. So we are actually collaborating with them to look at what is the outcome in primary angle closure glaucoma. There's no report worldwide of this laser effect in primary angle closure glaucoma. And we have finished about 60 eyes so far. And I think the data will be published shortly. So all said and done, it looks very nice and rosy. It looks like you have got a laser which is wonderful and works very well in most of the so-called advanced and moderate glaucomas, where you want to really the so-called reduce the intraocular pressure using a cyclodestructive procedure. You should actually look up, many of you who are very critical about the laser, you should probably read this interesting editorial by our wise owl in glaucoma, as we call him, the veteran Harry Quigley. He has written a nice article, editorial in the Academy's Ophthalmology, the need for rigor in evaluating micropulse and newer procedures. It makes very interesting reading. He does believe that this should not be used as a primary treatment, and any kind of treatment which is now offered by the companies, so take it with a pinch of salt, do your own evaluation, do your own, for each particular method, each particular surgeon, each clinical situation can be different. You cannot actually apply the same principle and same settings and protocol for a diverse kind of different etiologies of secondary glaucomas. So my take home message here, as far as the micropulse CPC is concerned, is that it is a safe and an effective alternative to the continuous wave. If you're already using the continuous wave CPC, kindly switch over if you can afford it. Can be used in moderate and advanced glaucomas and even in eyes with vision potential and not just blind eyes and absolute eyes with no vision and so on. You can do it in seeing eyes, but may reduce the need for medication, but total complete success unlikely. You will end up using at least a couple of drops, if not 2 or 3 medication. Fewer complications definitely than the continuous wave CPC. It is not recommended as a routine primary treatment. Do not offer it as a primary treatment for mild glaucomas. Moderate glaucomas and severe glaucomas, after something has been tried, you can definitely offer it. You need some experience. Do not think that it is a primary treatment as for mild glaucomas. Better to avoid it in recent surgery and inflammation. Serious concerns about the vision loss, about 1 or 2 line vision loss, which is unexplained. So therefore, you need to have a prior informed written consent from patients that there can be a mild vision loss in some patients, and that has to be kept in mind and informed. We're still working on what could be the reason for the vision loss and so on. It is not accommodative. It is not a macular problem. We don't really know the reason for this 1 or 2 line vision loss, which can actually persist. So therefore, obviously, we need longer term studies. We need a continuous follow-up. Maybe in the years to come, we'll have much more information on this. I think till then, I think we need to continue to use it with caution. And definitely, it is not to be offered and not to be taken lightly. My sincere thanks to the Cochin Ophthalmic Club for having me here today, this evening. And very nice to interact with you all. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Murli. It was really a wonderful talk, like always, very concise and very clear views put forward. two major concerns at the outset that I would like to raise. One is the first line of that slide you did not mention at all. That is the, you know, the bunching together of cases and the cost involved. I think.
Oh, I see. Should, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Yeah. It's okay. Yeah. That is one of the main concerns regarding the MicroPulse.
Correct.
So I think you can say a few sentences about that. And number two, my second question is, have you followed up these patients using a visual field? And have you seen loss of field in spite of, you know, control of pressure? Have you seen something like loss of field? Or something like wipeouts, and you know what we are really worried about in advanced doing advanced TRABs in advanced glaucoma. So have you noticed any such changes?
Very good question, and I think I somehow missed out on the cost part, which is very important for us in our economics of practice these days. So the probe actually the machine costs about somewhere between, say, 15 to 18 lakhs, depending on the so-called whatever pricing, which the euro or the dollar, those kind of exchanges. It's an expensive machine. It's a standalone machine. It cannot be used for anything else, the one that comes from IRIDEX. I believe there's one more machine which comes from Quantel, which can actually be used for multiple applications like retina and other things and all that. But the one that comes from IRIDEX can be applied and can be used only for glaucoma, standalone, can't be used for anything else. So it is a standalone glaucoma laser, one. Second is the probe comes with an RFID tag and can be used only for the 90 minutes in which it is connected. The machine has to be connected to a UPS and pray that the UPS and the machine doesn't conk off. Otherwise, your 25,000 rupees for the probe goes waste. So you have to pile up at least 3 to 5 patients. That's what I usually do. We initially used to do 6 and 8, and I even gone up to 9 and 10 and so on. I do find that beyond the 6th patient, the efficacy seems to come down. So therefore, we do the one-eyes, the ones who really need the young patients, we do it first in the list. Like how we do our surgical list also, we take priority for the first few patients. All the one-eyes and the priority patients who need the lowering, we do it in the first few. And then you take the third and the fourth, and sometimes we add a couple of free patients in the end. So usually we end up doing about 5 or 6 at the most. But the average thing is about 3 patients. Less than 3 doesn't make sense to do it. So one patient becomes very, very expensive. I sometimes combine it with, very rarely, with cataract surgery when the patient cannot come back outstationed overseas. Some overseas patients want to come in and say, I want everything done at the same time. Very rarely I have done a topical phaco and the cyclophotocoagulation at the same time. But I don't think it's advisable to do both at the same time. It can be done. People have described that. If for neovascular glaucoma, sometimes you can combine with an injection anti-VEGF along with this destruction. Again, that is not the ideal. Probably doing 2-stage, doing the injection first and then doing the laser, this destruction, cyclophotocoagulation is probably better. That's as far as the cost is concerned. And second, about your question about the visual field loss. So far, luckily, all patients are on good follow-up as far as my patients are concerned. The ones who come from abroad, the ones who are like going back to the referral doctor and so on, I would not be able to comment on the visual field. But nobody has actually come back saying that they have lost the central vision. There has been no wipeout as far as my series is concerned, and no serious complications like hypotony, irreversible hypotony, and choroidal sympathetic. Nothing has happened. No detachment so far. Maybe we are playing it really cautiously and really evaluating and looking at these kind of patients. But no serious complications, no wipeouts, and no detachment so far. And we continue to monitor these patients. Some of them have 360, 160 vision, post PKs, and sometimes we can't do a field to monitor them. So the only way to monitor would be intraocular pressure and their quality of vision and so on. Patients sometimes call back and say that the vision is okay, I'm maintaining at the same level and so on. But your question is definitely, I think as you go on to do more and more moderate glaucomas and glaucomas in which you have a good visual field, it's possible. I think we definitely need to monitor them.
Dr. Murli, you can switch on your video.
Yeah.
And there are a few questions in the YouTube
chat box. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You would like to ask, sir? Yeah.
No. You carry on.
Okay. So Dr. Sandhya Raju wants to know, how long will the effect last?
Okay. Laser actually, when it works well, it works to the extent of about 20-30% or 35% IOP lowering. In most patients, it would last between, say, 6 months to a year. I'm now having follow-up of about 3 years now in many patients. So it does seem to last up to 2 to 3 years in many patients. It tends to wear off in about a year or so. And the medication is continued. And a repeat laser is definitely possible. In many patients, in say about 1/5 of the patients, I do a repeat laser after about 6 months or a year or longer. Repeat laser is possible. So we can expect that it will last anywhere between 6 months to 2 years, if not longer.
Okay. The next question that was asked was, is there any precaution to be taken while we are doing it on a pediatric patient? And another question just along with that is it possible to do it in uveitic glaucomas?
Yeah, but pediatric patients, I have done quite a few. Juveniles, I do it quite often. Even, say, 16-year-olds, 20-year-olds, as we do a local anesthetic, we can do it under local anesthesia. But very young children, I recently did a 5-year-old boy who had congenital cataract, rubella cataracts, had secondary glaucoma, had traps both eyes, had tubes both eyes. Still nothing is working. Still the pressure was high. I have done a bilateral micropulse for this child last week. And this child has actually done extremely well. The pressure has come down by about 40%. So the only issue is when you have a distorted globe anatomy, you have buphthalmic eyes, you will have difficulty in locating the ciliary body as I was showing you. And you need to know and you need to transilluminate to see where the possible ciliary body is. That is one. Second is we don't have too much of a follow-up and we don't have a large number of patients with juvenile glaucoma or pediatric glaucoma. So I can't give you a definite answer as to will it work in every pediatric glaucoma and so on. But I think it can definitely be done. There are many reports, many publications on the use of micropulse in children. But like everything else we worry about in children is the long-term effect. These kids are going to be having a long lifespan. So whether we are doing the right thing is what we all need to worry about.
Okay. Laila, madam, yeah. So I think the that answers the question. Next question that has come is, how to decide whether one quadrant or two quadrant is required?
Okay. See, the company actually recommends, once you get the machine, the company recommends doing 360, in the sense do both superior and inferior in one sitting. Don't go back and do one more sitting. It is advisable to do both superior and inferior hemisphere on all patients, 2000 energy and 80 seconds inferior, 80 seconds superior for all patients. But that is not the correct thing to do. We all know that. So what we do, suppose you have a milder glaucoma or a moderate glaucoma in whom you don't want a very severe lowering or very, lowering beyond, say, 30% or more. What you can do is you can probably reduce the duration. I usually reduce the duration to 50 seconds. Instead of 80 seconds, I make it 50 seconds. And suppose if I want, let us say, a more extensive, IOP lowering, what I do is I do 360. And the second sitting, what I do is I do a spot, single spot application in a second sitting, the inferior 180. So you can actually modify as per the patient and the eye. You don't really have the same protocol. As a single standard protocol, you can say 360 degrees, 80 seconds, 2000. If you can scale down, reduce the duration to 50 seconds. If you want to add on, you can do a single spot application, one more hemi field or maybe one more quadrant. I think it is probably left to the surgeon's discretion. We don't really have a definite answer and a definite protocol is not there.
How many times can we repeat the procedure?
I have repeated twice so far in about maybe 3 or 4 patients. And many patients, I have done it twice. And this is over the last 2-3 years. Most patients are comfortable and they actually appreciate that a laser is less so-called invasive than a surgical procedure. And because they're able to wash their face and they sort of able to get back to work immediately in the next few days, most people feel that compared to an incisional procedure, this probably is less invasive. So the acceptance is actually better. And they say in the COVID time, the company has been aggressively promoting it as a alternative to incisional surgery and saying that this is probably better than going to the theater and so on. But that is not really true. It's a company-driven motive. But I think definitely it is definitely less invasive and less stressful as far as surgeon is concerned.
As a connection to that, Murali, how early can you expect the IOP to come down? I mean, what is the natural way this laser works?
day one, it drops. The pressure drop is on day one, within day three. Most often, the pressure drops within a few days. And then, in fact, the drop can be sometimes 8 to 10 or even 15 millimeters the first few days. And then slowly, it can actually build up and then stabilizes within about 3 to 4 weeks. You will find that your decision to scale down the medication should be taken between 2 weeks to a month. The first week, first 2 weeks, don't do anything. Just continue. Maybe you can take off one drug, something like if you have brimonidine, which is causing loss of a lot of redness, or some intolerance to one particular medication, that alone can be taken off. Probably give a little oral estezolamide to keep that pressure in the acceptable range if it's a one-night patient and so on. Decide on the medication, the need for medication, the second week to the fourth week. In a month, you can take a decision. But don't totally stop using medication. That is not advisable.
Before so we go ahead, Manoj, 1 second. Can I just introduce Dr. Devin Tully? Devin, are you there?
Yes, sir, I'm there. But I told you the reason, so I'll keep my video off.
Keep your video off, Devin.
You can see some people behind me, so you know where I am.
Devin is in a very welcome situation. He's in a physical meeting, something that we are dreaming about for quite some time.
Thank you for the opportunity and hello to everyone in Cochin.
So Dr. Devan is a very senior glaucoma consultant in Delhi. He had a senior residency and post-graduation in the Guru Nanak Eye Center, MAMSI. He did his fellowship in glaucoma at the RP Center. And he also has a clinical fellowship in glaucoma from the US. So, and a very, very active, vibrant member of the Glaucoma Society of India. And one of the persons who is really looking forward to the Cochin conference in 2023. Okay, so Manoj, can you please go ahead with your question?
Now, Devan, you are in spotlight. Can we see? Yeah.
I hope you can because I'm using my mobile.
And We can see you.
Thank you.
Murali
sir, my question was, how early can we repeat the procedure if you are not getting adequate control?
If the pressure is not responded or if you don't get a response initial, say, month or so, don't repeat. Which means there's something wrong in either the settings or the laser or the way you applied it or the response to the treatment. Don't repeat it if it has not worked at all. Look at some other alternative. But if it has worked well, the pressure has come down and it has maintained for, say, at least a few months or maybe 6 months or longer, then if it starts wearing off or the pressure starts building up, then you can repeat. I would not repeat at least until about 6 months or so, 3 to 6 months. Not less than 3 months for sure. If it has not worked at all, don't repeat.
So what about its use in scleritis and uveitis?
If it is active uveitis, definitely no. Don't do it in active uveitis. If you have an active uveitic glaucoma, you are actually directly touching the so-called ciliary body, ciliary pars plana area and so on. You're going to definitely cause more inflammation. So I would not do it in active uveitis, maybe very quiet uveitis, completely sort of quietened down and no episode of uveitis in the last 6 months, then I would consider it. But uveitic glaucoma, I would really be wary and I would probably keep it as a last resort. Look at other options before you look at cyclodesert.
Okay, post-trabeculectomy, which would be the site where you would want to do this? That's one question. The other question is, in your series, what has been the percentage of failure and which are the cases which actually failed?
Yeah, great question. See, the when you have a trab done and you have a thin so-called avascular, almost like no vasculature, the so-called mitomycin blebs, those are the blebs you would actually let alone. Though you don't want to go rub on them and do a laser probe application on top of a thin avascular cystic bleb. Leave the bleb area and do maybe 270 degrees and leave that quadrant alone. But otherwise, if you have a fibrotic bleb and the bleb is not worked and you have a thin, what you call thick sclera, vascularized area, you can treat it like anything else. So that is as far as the bleb is concerned. If you have a buccal or if you have a tube somewhere, or if you have a thin sclera, ectatic area, staphylomatous area, all those you leave alone. You can't do 360 in those kind of areas where you would not, you have the risk of so-called going through and through the sclera. Avoid those areas. Avoid areas of blood clots if you're given a block and there's a huge hematoma. You would even defer it for some time. Don't do it on the hematoma. Then regards to your question of, what is the other question, Gopal?
Which are the cases in
which didn't work? The failures. Yeah. So the ones which usually don't work are the ones are the VR surgery glaucomas. In the ones you have in your specialty. So the ones which have so-called silicon oil, invariably, I'm not blaming any of you, but I do find that after the VR surgery is done, the retina is excellent, the disc is pale, patient sees hand movements, and everything looks good as far as the retina is concerned. The pressure is very, very high. The tubes are in place. The tubes get blocked with the oil and so on. But still, somehow, there seems to be emulsified oil sticking in the angle. So, despite AC wash and despite tubes and everything, and despite the cycloid photocoagulation, I do find that the post-VR, post-silicon oil, it simply doesn't seem to work. And those are my actually the dreaded ones in which it doesn't seem to work at all. Sometimes I do find silicon oil subconjunctival, those bubbles sticking all around the conjunctiva and so on. Post-PK, it works wonderfully. Post-PK glaucomas, it is a really nice thing to do. Post-traps, post-tubes, everything else, it works well. But I think you can't really generalize as one single situation. But by and large, I think each individual eye has to be taken as a so-called response to treatment. But in our series, we found that the least response, the less responsive ones are the ones who have silicon oil, post-silicon oil, even after silicon oil removal and so on.
One of the reasons could be, Murli, is that many of these silicon oil or post VR glaucomas actually have an angle closure component.
Yes.
And unless you really take care of that, what I have been doing is that not in this situation, but many post VR glaucomas, I'm doing a trab, opening up sinuculysis, and opening up, we do a large PI, sometimes multiple laser YAG PIs you do, but they get closed again and
they get closed. Absolutely.
Yeah. So
you won't even know where you did the PI.
I think three or four recent cases I've done a trab, I've just with a spatula just removed, released all the sinuca, made the chamber deep, all of them the traps failed. Yeah, I think correct. Because of the inflammation. But then this maneuver of relieving the angle thing itself has reduced the intraocular pressure. Although the trab is nothing great, there is not much of filtration through the trab.
So what I end up doing, actually what I do is, yours actually makes sense. In the sense, ones which I do, there's no place to do a trab. Invariably, it is all scarred. There is no conjunctiva. You can't even dissect conjunctiva. So what I usually do is I do one sitting of the micropulse CPC, cyclophotocoagulation. And if I find that it doesn't work, then I go in and put in an inferonasal tube. So that is the one that works best in my hands. I go in and do an inferonasal RD or something like that. Because it's nowhere else you can put a tube. Inferonasal is the last resort.
If there are no more questions, can we move on, Abhilash, to the panel discussion? And have Murli, Devin and Manoj in the panel. Abhilash, you can start. You can just explain what you're planning to do to the three
Arun
panelists.
Also.
Yeah.
Arun also.
Yeah. Arun is also there. I'll also chip in whenever possible.
So at the outset, I'd like to thank COC for this opportunity. I'll start my screen share. So the topic is what is my first drug of choice in this glaucoma? I have a few cases. Case scenarios, and what we'll do is
full screen.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I'll present these cases, and we can discuss how each of us would go about managing these cases. And the cases per se are straightforward ones. They are not much of a diagnostic challenge as such. But each of us would probably have our own way of dealing with these cases. And I'd like to thank my colleagues, Dr. Manju and Dr. Afzal, for helping me put this all together. So I'll go on to my first case. So we have a 70-year-old gentleman who's hypertensive for the past 24 years, and he has come with complaints of decrease in vision in the left eye of 1 year duration. His best corrected visual acuity is 6.9 and 6 in both eyes. He has early cataract. The intraocular pressure is 22 in the right eye, 29 in the left eye. Lunoscopy shows the angles open up to the CRISPR. this findings, I'll show the this photo. The right eye is around 0.75 cupping. And there's some inferior thinning. While in the left eye, it's both superior as well as inferior thinning with the RNFL defects. There is some RPE changes at the macula. Peripapillary atrophy prominent in the left eye. These are the fields. Right eye is showing few something like superior nasal step. The left eye is 10-2 field showing advanced field loss. And OCT of the RNFL is showing advanced thinning in the left eye. The corneal thickness is 591 and 594. So basically, this is an open-angle glaucoma case. Usual cases that we encounter in the OPD. So, what drug would you start with? Murali sir, please just take this. Would you start all your open-angle glaucoma patients on the same drug, or would you, choose your patients and what you start?
See, obviously, I think you're dealing with advanced glaucoma and a relatively older patient with a little cataract, and you're having a field which is close to fixation and so on. You don't really have too much time to sort of wait and look at response to treatments. I would probably give the first drug which works the best and try to get a target pressure somewhere between, say, 14 to 18 is what is my initial target, at least, the left eye. The right eye looks much better, of course. So I would straight away start off with a prostaglandin, at least for the left eye, and of course the right eye as well, because there does seem to be glaucoma on the right eye also. So start with the prostaglandin, look at the response to treatment, and given the advanced nature of the glaucoma and maybe having this little bit of cataract in the patient, I would probably look at a surgical option after starting off the lowering of the intraocular pressure. I would be more inclined towards surgery than continuing with medication in the long term.
So what about the systemic issues that was mentioned? Did I miss those?
I think you said hypertension.
Hypertension
alone, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Hypertension, okay. Yeah, that's great.
No cardiac problem or that.
Yeah, so 50% lowering, 50% lowering is good to go, because 14, as Murali said, 14, 15, and you mentioned the pressure as 27, is that correct?
Yes, 29, I think.
29, yeah. So I think only a prostaglandin may not work, probably because 30-35% lowering, you need about 45-50% lowering. So, and with hypertension, depending on the drug he's taking for hypertension, we could also, include a combination of prostaglandin, timolol. That would be good. Timolol will be good for the hypertension also. But yeah, we also have to look at timolol as a choice, because, very advanced glaucoma, at times that blunts the nighttime, the nighttime pressure may not be as lowered as we want. So yeah, it's still okay to give prostaglandin timolol, and can also next step, if required, we can look at something like a brimonidine. I am presuming there is nothing in the carotid or nothing like that. So something like a brimonidine, which helps in advanced glaucoma cases. Yeah, but always start with the one bottle and probably a prostaglandin timolol. If beta blocker is not being used systemically, if that is being used, we can request the physician to change to another class of antihypertensive, because we need to give timolol.
Abhilash, in between, I think you'll have to stop sharing so that people can see the discussions.
So I'll Sai sir, I'll keep my video off, because like I said,
that's okay. That's okay.
Yeah.
So if you can stop sharing, Abhilash. In between two cases.
What would be your take?
Thank you. Please go ahead. Yeah.
Murali, what's your take on timolol in advanced glaucomas? Would you be comfortable doing that?
No, actually, what I would like to do here is maybe as a general principle of treatment. Generally, I don't like to start a combination as a first choice, unless you're really desperate to lower the intraocular pressure in a very quick time. But this patient is probably having a glaucoma, as you can see, for many years. It's not something which has come overnight. So you don't really need to give a combination. So you give one drug, see the effect of the drug in a few weeks' time, and then decide when you have the patient sort of gets back to get your confidence and build up the rapport with the, how we are going, get a proper evaluation done, look at other aspects of everything else, and then slowly consider adding a second drug. Because unless one drug is given, you don't really know its maximum efficacy in this given situation. So give one drug as a logical treatment, look at the efficacy, and then decide to add or substitute. So don't give a combination as a first rational unless your pressure is very, very high and it's one-eyed and so on. This is my logic generally. And with this kind of a patient and situation, I am more surgically inclined than medically inclined. So
Would you consider giving timolol at all if needed in the second go?
I would probably give prostaglandin first, and if the pressure comes down satisfactorily, but the target is probably say still in the 20s and 22, if it comes down, I would probably consider making it a combination with timolol. But timolol and prostaglandin is well tolerated.
And the next scenario, which I see a lot of our general colleagues doing here in Delhi, is they give 2-3 days of acetazolamide so that the pressure comes down, and then probably, and also start prostaglandin simultaneously. So any merit in that?
Most people don't tolerate the oral drugs so well, and many people have this fatigue. And so unless it's an acute situation preoperatively or something like that, or if you're doing some other intervention, I don't generally give for short-term acetazolamide as far as treatment is concerned, but invariably they don't tolerate. So maybe Dr. Abhilash, Arun and Sai can come in.
Regarding the timolol, I think as Devan said, in the second round, if my target is not reached, probably if my target is still slightly far away, I would go in for a combination of carbonic anhydrase inhibitor with timolol. I mean, that is my favorite drug after I start the prostaglandin. And I'm not a great fan of this once daily timolol either. What is available along with the prostaglandin analog. So if you're starting PGO, start PGA alone first. Assess the fall in intraocular pressure. And then if you really have to add something and keep the pressure really low at somewhere around 12, then my choice usually is a combination of a CA inhibitor with timolol, if there are no contraindications, obviously. Arun or Manoj, you want to make some comment on that before we can go on to the next scenario?
Yeah, I agree with the thing that we don't need to start with Diamox oral to bring down the pressure, because patient has been tolerating this pressure for long. We don't need to acutely bring down the pressure. So it is just all right to start with topical alone.
Sir, regarding carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, do you use dorflamide or brinzolamide? If you are using a combination, do you specifically use any particular drug? Or do you find the same efficacy for both?
The combination that I use is dorflamide with timolol. But I think brinzolamide with timolol should work equally well.
Yeah, I think between brinzolamide and brinzolamide, it's only a matter of tolerance, and brinzolamide seems to be better tolerated, and it seems to be more company-driven side effects than anything else.
Exactly.
I think we have been using dorflamide timolol for
so many years.
I don't really think it's a big issue, but the way the companies would project it as if it's a crime to prescribe
timolol. It causes so much stinging.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So keep that in mind. Your clinician's judgment is far, far better than any other pharma company driven brochure.
Dr. Thomas,
some patients where there's advanced damage and you want to bring it down quickly, sometimes I give a half BD Diamox, just a very small dose, half BD, maybe for 4-5 days, just while the effect of the prostaglandin is kicking in. But that's only in where advanced damage and you want to the effect to start very quickly, only in those cases. Limited case. Thank you.
Murali sir, supposing your target was, in this case, the patient is having advanced glaucoma in the left eye. In the right eye, what would you start? Because he's having early glaucoma.
Yeah, the same prostaglandin, because anyway, with the convenience for the patient, we use one drug. So we use prostaglandin in both eyes once at night, see the efficacy in about 2 weeks. And if you are, I would generally, like I said, I am more surgically inclined. I would probably plan and prime the patient towards surgery in the left eye, maybe a combined surgery or something like that in the left eye. And right eye would probably keep him on medication. And if the cataract increases or something, let's think of just the cataract alone in the right eye. That may be enough for him for the right eye. But for the left eye, he may need a combined surgery.
And I would like to give prostaglandins in both eyes, just because otherwise unioclear side effects will be disfiguring to the patient. The retinas and periorbital pigmentation, all those things will be troubles.
Also, if the patient was younger, did you start with another medicine? Because as you said, prostaglandin associated orbital problems would be magnified if the patient uses drugs for many decades. Or would you rather do surgery earlier? Devan sir.
So I would not go for surgery. This thing, my limit is up to 2 bottles. Yeah, but keeping the elderly. Yeah, you said the younger patient.
Yeah, if the patient was younger, no, this is rather elderly patient. You have a younger patient.
Younger patient, I would be less inclined towards surgery. I would definitely consider up to 2 bottles of medication. And actually, incidentally, what Dr. Sai said, my approach is very similar. My choice is second drug is a dorzolamide timolol combination bottle. So I think, Sai sir, we are matching in that regard. So
younger patients will have less compliance to medication. That's what I found, especially while working.
That's what's starting. I would not jump to surgery straight away in a younger patient. Older patient, yes, with cataract and all, like Murli said, I think it's okay. If you're going in for cataract surgery, then it's okay to combine it with TRAB. But I would not jump to surgery until I have given a trial of up to 2 bottles of medication.
How is the angle? Is there enough trabecular pigmentation in the angle? If it had been a younger patient and if there's an inclination and you can offer actually an SLT to the patient, I would think of SLT as well.
And we move on to the next case, Avilash.
Sai sir, there is no disturbance on from my front, no, because I am standing in one corner.
There is a small voice over. That is okay.
Yeah, we are attending the other meeting in Delhi also.
Two birds. No.
Actually, this is. I'll show you if I flip the. It's already 100 people here. Go ahead.
Thankfully,
go ahead.
Corona doesn't come through Zoom. So.
Thankfully, yes. By the way, we all look forward to Guwahati and let's hope so.
So, I'll go ahead with the second of my case scenarios. We have a 63-year-old lady who has thyroid dysfunction and dyslipidemia. She has a family history of glaucoma. Her sister is having glaucoma. And she has actually presented with irritation and swelling of the lids. So, coming to the breast cataract specialty is 6-6 and 6 in both eyes. She has early cortical cataract. Otoscopy is again open up to the pleuric curve. IOP is around 16 millimeters from mercury. And the disc photo looks like this. So, with 16 millimeters of mercury, right eye is having an inferior rim loss with wedge arnacle defect and a superior notch with slit defect. The left eye is almost similar. The defect is more in the left eye. The inferior wedge as well as the superior slit defect with bipolar notching. This is the field. Right eye is having a superior arcuate scotoma, inferior is a dense nasal slit, right eye denser arcuate and inferior scotoma. This is the macular field. Macula is involved, right, and the left and the right. The OCT also mirrors the image, mirrors the findings that we see on the disc. The corneal thickness is normal. So here we have a patient with 16 pressures, normal tension glaucoma, family history is positive. She's having thyroid and dyslipidemia. And she's coming for the first time. So how do we go about this? Any systemic evaluation you go for before you start medicines? You check for any other problem that might be there for the patient.
You want me to go first?
Yeah, sure, sir. Okay.
Yeah, I think obviously we need some kind of a baseline physician evaluation to look at common things like sugar, blood pressure, and thyroid, and everything else. As far as systemic, you have a good assessment of the patient to rule out rheumatological problems, and then of course look at the ocular surface. As you said, patient has intolerance and some redness and probably dysthyroid kind of problems. Look at the ocular surface. Maybe have somebody who's, if you have a colleague who can look at the ocular surface and give you a good assessment as to is there a mild dry eye or some kind of an ocular surface dysfunction. Look at that, look at the systemic history, and then consider the patient's glaucoma. Obviously, you're dealing with a glaucoma in which the pressure is only 16 in one measurement. Obviously, one measurement is not going to be enough. We need to have some kind of a day variation measurement in the pressures. So measure the pressure a couple of times, at least 3-4 times in a day, in different days of the week, can get an idea of what is the so-called highest pressure and the lowest pressure. A true diurnal will be very difficult for us to do in a clinical situation. So at least get a day variation, get the highest and the lowest, and get an idea of what the highest pressure and the lowest pressure is for this patient before we start treatment as a baseline. I think the ocular surface is okay, and glaucoma seems to be moderate to advanced, like in the situation the pressure is not too high. You can probably start off again with the preservative-free prostaglandin. We have choice of so many bag-free and preservative-free prostaglandin. We'll probably co-prescribe a lubricant, but I would first start off with a preservative-free or a bag-free prostaglandin to start with, after having a good systemic evaluation and having somebody look at the ocular surface as well.
Yeah, I think that's good. We're dealing with a normal tension situation. So, again, the gonioscopy was open. Did I miss that?
Yes, sir, it was open.
Yeah. So, I think it's very important for the audience to understand in this case it's open, but a lot of these situations where normal tension is labeled, it may actually be, you know, angle closure with a narrow angle at present, but it may turn occludable. So that's very important to rule out, and good that it's been ruled out in this case. Barring the ocular surface, if we discount the ocular surface issue, for me, if you have to start one drug, which is a theme of the symposium, then in normal tension situations, it should be a prostaglandin, because you need about 30% lowering straight away in normal tension. With one drug, prostaglandin, it would give you. It's also important to select the correct prostaglandin in this. And in my choice of the ocular surface, my disclaimer is if we are discounting the ocular surface issue, then I think we have to consider something like a bimatoprost, because that gives a higher IOP lowering. But yeah, it will also have more ocular surface issues. So that is there. And timolol should be avoided in these cases, because normal tension, you don't know, the nighttime pressure is so crucial. Dorzolamide is a good drug to use if required as a second drug in this, because it will augment the ocular blood flow. It's difficult to measure it, but augments it. And some authors would claim that vimonidine could be the second drug because of that so-called neuroprotective or field salvaging effect. That is what I had to say, sir. Go ahead.
Devin, I think excellent comments regarding this. Just to intervene, I'm sorry. We have more than 200 views on YouTube as of now, live. So much more than we would expect in any physical meeting.
The Cochin Ophthalmic Club is very popular. We often log into it, even if we are not faculty, I often log into it whenever there's a glaucoma program.
Thank you. And we have a huge collection of programs right from the last February. So whoever is interested can go through the programs in the Cochin Ophthalmic Club YouTube channel. Murli, one question is, you mentioned about the diurnal variation. Yeah. What do you do practically? Actually, how do you do? I mean, this is something that we probably don't do properly because of logistic issues. Yeah.
Yeah, it bugs us all the time. So what I usually do is, say today I've seen this patient most probably in the afternoon morning session. I would record the pressure once in the morning. I would call back the patient some other day, maybe two measurements in the afternoon, say afternoon 3 o'clock and evening at about say 7 o'clock, and some other day the morning 2 readings. So I would be happy with 4 readings in a day and different times of the week, and use that as a day variation in the pressure. That's what I usually do. It is impractical to do anything more than that.
Sir, I would actually not call it a diurnal. We do exactly
a day variation.
We would do exactly what Murli has suggested, but the nomenclature for the audience now should be a weekly variation rather than, you know, we do it different times of the day over 1 week.
But what if you have to take a decision on diagnosis based on that? For example, you want to call this, I'm going to say this is an open angle glaucoma and not a normal tension glaucoma. Because if I actually measure the diurnal, if I get one reading of 22 or 24, then it's not an NTG.
It isn't. So, sir, that's what I said. A lot of these patients actually turn out to be narrow angle or angle closure, which in this case has been ruled out. But yeah, a lot of our colleagues don't do gonio. So that is for them. And also, if you do a weekly variation or a diurnal variation, actually, it doesn't stay normal tension. It becomes a high pressure glaucoma or the normal or the, you know, the usual glaucoma, like we say, the POAG. So that is a very important thing before labeling these.
See, frankly speaking, Sai, actually, I wouldn't really worry about giving it a name. I don't worry about is it normal tension or open angle or primary, what you call as POAG and so on, high pressure and so on. So basically, here's a situation in home, you're having a field defect, you're having an RNF field defect. This is by definition a typical glaucoma. So a glaucoma is a spectrum in which you have people having lower pressures, moderate pressures and high pressures. Any population-based study also, you will find that the pressure is actually not too high. In most of the population, you can still call it glaucoma. So don't worry about calling it NTG, calling it low pressure glaucoma or anything like that. You want to treat the patient to an extent to which you're going to slow down the progression of glaucoma. So here the bottom line would be establishing a baseline pressure, measure it a couple of times or 3-4 times, get the baseline. Then you put in a drug or whatever choice of drug you want and look at the response to treatment. Once the response to treatment is satisfactory, response to treatment by mean, the intraocular pressure must come down by at least 3 to 4 millimeters of mercury. If it does not come down by less than 2 millimeters, the drug is not working at all. You change the drug or change the method of treatment. If it is working well, you will follow up the patient. Suppose you don't, like in this patient, you're having one eye close to fixation. You probably need a lower target, as low as you would like it to be. Start with one drug, keep evaluating the fields every 3 to 4 months. If I find the slightest evidence of worsening or progression, I would either step up the treatment or think of some other intervention. We don't want the patient to get worse despite whatever you do. The basic idea of glaucoma treatment is to stop things getting worse. So treat the pressure. That's the only thing you can do. Follow up the patient, look at the field and look for progression. Do a fields at least about 2-3 times in the first year. At least 2-3 times in the first year so as to get some kind of an idea of the rate of progression. If this patient is worsening rapidly, then you can pick it up by doing at least a couple of fields in the year. So 2-3 fields for sure. Even the second field can be done free to get the goodwill of the patient. Otherwise, people feel that you're charging the patient repeatedly. So I usually do the second field free of charge just to get the goodwill and then follow up and then keep following up. So make sure you don't lose the patient as far as progression is concerned.
So you would still wait for a week, have 4 or 5 values at different points of time in the day,
yes,
before you start your treatment.
Is that if the patient is somewhere in the local area of Chennai and not COVID area and can't come back and so on, then straight away I would start treatment. I would
exactly.
not
that
wait
is the point,
for,
That is the point
yeah,
I wanted
do
to
do. Do not yeah. wait. Patient is from, let us say, a far off place, 100 kilometers away. Then no, I will not say this is not glaucoma. You are sure this is glaucoma, no doubt about it. So straight away you are justified in starting treatment. Don't wait for the theoretical aspect of
exactly,
measuring
exactly.
pressure and so on.
Sometimes a prior one-time insult like a steroid-induced glaucoma may sometimes present right now as an NTG, which may not be a progressive disease. Mm-hmm. So we can ask for a history of steroid use, topical steroid use, ocular history of ocular allergy, self-medication.
Your trauma, probably, yeah. Should I go on to the next case?
I think you can go on to the next case, Abhilash.
So this is the third case. We have a 54-year-old gentleman who came for routine eye checkup. There are no systemic illnesses. the question is 6, 6, and 6. We have shallow anterior chamber. There are no angle structures seen on gonioscopy. Scattered peripheral anterior synechiae are noted on indentation. Intraocular pressure is 30 in the right end, 26 in the left eye. This are luckily normal. He did undergo YAC PI, and post YAC PI, his PIs were patent. After 2 weeks, the intraocular pressure reduced to 26 in the right eye and 24 in the left eye. He was kept on timolol following the YAC PI. And gonoscopy again shows some synechiae that are persisting. So these are the PIs that we made. The disc as well as the fields are normal. The OCT are normal. And so here we have this patient who has undergone YAC PI for anterior closure. His intraocular pressures are still high. And now how do we go about it? I think we should start off with Murali sir.
Any idea of the corneal thickness?
So corneal thickness I don't have right now.
I would just keep that factor in mind, even though it's not very, very important. I would just keep that factor in mind. Suppose you have a very thick cornea of 580 or 600. So we can probably factor in a few millimeters with that corneal thickness in mind. If you have a 540 thickness, then we are back to square one and you need to deal with an angle closure. You do seem to be having a, some kind of a PAC, primary angle closure situation. You have done a YAC PI, the pressure is still uncontrolled, and you're having apparently normal disc, normal field, and possibly normal OCT as well, I think. Is that right?
Yeah.
So it's probably a PAC with after post YAC PI, you have put only on timolol, and you're having synechiae and you're having areas of so-called peripheral anterior synechiae even after the YAC PI. So this patient is more likely to progress to angle closure glaucoma in the near future. You do need a lower pressure if the corneal thickness is, say, so-called average. So I would probably, without hesitation, put again on a prostaglandin, because the timolol alone is not going to be enough to lower a pressure of 24 or 26. Keep the start the patient on a prostaglandin and watch the response to treatment. Prostaglandins do work well even in angle closure glaucoma after a YAC PI, and needs close monitoring to see the response to treatment. Of course, do the fields and do the evaluation of the disc as well. The prostaglandin, I think, would be my choice here again. To start off with the prostaglandin. And because the angle, as you said, has opened up to a significant extent, probably I would think less of a plateau iris syndrome here than usually. Suppose it didn't open at all, I would think of a plateau iris syndrome also. But here, I think you'll be looking more at PAC than anything else. I would consider if you have a UBM or something, maybe you could do once just to look at how the relationship of the iris insertion to the ciliary body is. If you have a UBM, probably do it. Otherwise, it's not very important.
So you would probably
I missed the pressure. What was the pressure here?
So post PI, it is 26 and 24 on timolol.
Right. Okay. On timolol?
Yeah. Post PI, we started on timolol. And okay. After 2 weeks, it is now 26.
Yeah, yeah. So I think I all agree with Murali that it's okay to keep the pressure lower, and because this pressure is on a drug, then it's okay to substitute it with prostaglandins. I think the audience must know that in these situations, once a laser has been done, then the protocol for starting the medical treatment is very similar to that, you know, that we do for open angle. And post YAG also, prostaglandins have been shown to work very well. So I agree on that front.
For all practical purposes, can we consider this treatment like we treat ocular hypertension?
Ocular hypertension, really. Yeah. So it all depends on the target pressure. No, I think the target pressure 26 is a little on the higher side for comfort. So it's on timolol. So I think it's good to substitute it with prostaglandins. I think for me, the important thing is not just the IOP lowering of prostaglandin, it's also the good day and night time control of IOP. So that's also a factor to substitute to a prostaglandin.
See, the strictly speaking, the ocular hypertension definition actually refers to open angle glaucoma and thick corneas. So here we neither have the thick cornea situation nor we have an open angle. And angle closure glaucomas are notorious, in at least in the Asian Indian situation, to be silent and sort of slow, asymptomatic, and prevent to progress. So I would definitely start off, I would not treat it as ocular hypertension. I would treat it as angle closure and go ahead and start lowering the pressure and keep following up at least once in 6 months. This patient needs a 6 months follow-up and given a note that in case you're seeing some other eye doctor to be told that there's an angle closure situation and pressure has to be monitored at least on every 6 months basis, if not more.
I think to me, this is one situation where the prostaglandin is definitely the first line of choice. I think you should always think of that.
Rho kinase inhibitors have you given for angle closures that have opened up with PA? What is the role of rho kinase in situations like this? You have done the PA, the angles have opened up and you need a minute.
Devan,
you want to answer that? Rho kinase inhibitors in PACG?
I don't have personal experience in PAC, sir, but I see no reason why they should be used first line because we have less experience with that. So in a situation where you are, the patient is going for surgery already on two bottles, then I think we could consider, but with the less experience with those drugs, I'll be more comfortable with using a drug where, you know, we've had years of experience.
Longer follow-up. Okay.
Yeah. See, the problem with Rho kinase inhibitor is, one is it's a new drug, we don't really know all of it, all the aspects of the drug. One, second is it is not a cost-effective drug as far as its efficacy is concerned. So it lowers the intraocular pressure by, say, 20-25%. So it is not a primary drug for any kind of a primary glaucoma situation. You have here, you're dealing with the primary angle closure. So why would you want to give a drug which is less efficacious, relatively more expensive, probably has more hyperemia rates than any other drug we know of? And then, of course, we don't really know very well about all aspects of the drug. So I think a Rho kinase inhibitor is probably not the first choice here.
And I would just like to add frequent gonioscopy, just to make sure that the creeping angle closure.
This patient really needs a close follow-up as far as pressure and gonioscopy is concerned, and the disc and the field as well.
So follow-up is more important, I guess, for such patients where angle closure is suspected. I'll go on to the...
Yeah, you can go on to the next.
And just a quick comment about the previous patient again, that most of us who are cataract surgeons and you have a mild cataract in a 65-year-old with a PAC situation and you have pressures like this, and all of them who are excellent cataract surgeons can think of doing earlier cataract surgery. Because IOP lowering will definitely be better with doing a cataract surgery. The angle will open up. So here is a situation where it's an indication for early cataract surgery.
Okay. So the next case is a 57-year-old lady who was referred to a hospital for further management of retinal disease as well as glaucoma. She is a known hypertensive for past 11 years. Diabetic for past 9, cholesterol for past 9 years, and she has undergone diode cyclophotocoagulation in the right eye for pressure control. So the right eye is having no PR. There is a corneal opacity, few microvilli, and the anterior chamber is shallow. Gonioscopy could not be done because there is no view. The intraocular pressure is 56 in that eye, and disc findings are not very clear due to the vitreous hemorrhage. The left eye is having 6-6 part sensing vision. There's shallow peripheral anterior chamber with florid NVA. The gonioscopy shows it's opening up to the scleral spur in parts, but scattered PAS is there. There is also NVA. The intraocular pressure is 32, and disc finding, disc is normal, but picture of the iris with new vessels, and this is the under photo. The disc appears normal in the left eye. There are features of diabetic retinopathy with scattered NVE along the course of the vessel. So this is an NVG patient, one night patient. So we go for early surgery or start on medicine. Of course, the retinal part has to be taken care of, the injections or places have to be done. But as far as glaucoma is concerned, how do we go about patients having 6/6 vision as of now?
I think essentially we are dealing with the secondary glaucoma here. It is obviously due to the proliferative diabetic retinopathy here. So obviously we need a multi-specialty approach. We need a physician who is going to monitor the medical problems. So we need a retinal colleague also who deals with the retinal problem as well. Even though right eye is no peel, it can become painful blindness. So we have to keep that in mind as far as the retina problem is concerned. So left eye, I think, has to be addressed from the retinal point of view first. So maybe the PRP or whatever the retinal colleague is planning is probably the first choice. So that's a better eye, seeing eye, 6/6 vision. So the choice of anti-VEGF or choice of PRP is first left to the retinal surgeon to deal with the PDR first. And medically, you control the IOP to the best extent possible with the maximum available medication which you can offer to the patient to get the IOP down till a definitive retinal treatment is done, like a PRP or a whatever method of injection or whatever the retinal surgeon is going to do. And then still, despite everything, if the pressure in the left eye after PRP and after medical treatment, the pressure still remains high, I would probably think of a mitomycin trabeculectomy first, keeping in mind that there may be the need for doing a tube little later. So don't do the, probably I would center the trabeculectomy at the superior level. I can leave the nasal and the temporal side available for a future retrap or maybe a subsequent tube or something like that. So do a trap with mitomycin in the near future. But first priority is to medical treatment. Second priority to get the retina colleague to treat the PDR and then deal with the surgical management. Definitely you need to do a go in surgically. Medically, you don't have much of an option in this patient as far as IOP is concerned.
Yeah, I think in the present scenario, I think anti-VEGF forms a very, very important part of the management in such situations. And like Murali said, our protocol also will be to just, you know, start off with topical medications like dorzolamide, timolol, but it won't be much effective. And then give an anti-VEGF, give a window for the retinal, you know, surgeon to do a proper PRP and, you know, try and reduce as much of the retinal ischemia as possible. And if the pressure is still high, then obviously go in with a mitomycin trab and then probably a tube. Murali, in relation to your talk, I would like to ask two questions. One is, does the micropulse diode, I mean, fit in anywhere in the management of this particular scenario?
In the right eye. In the right eye, you're having a no PL situation. Already one diode has been done. Mm. And if the one more anti-VEGF can be given, if there is frank, full-blown, florid NVE or NVE and the iris all over, you see blood vessels, then you go and do something, you're going to end up with a total hyphema. So better give an anti-VEGF even in the right eye. And within a week or two of the anti-VEGF, I would probably do 360 degree cyclophotocoagulation for the right eye. And left eye, I would be less inclined to do cyclophotocoagulation because the retina has not been treated at all. So probably wait for the left eye and consider a mitomycin trab rather than doing something which can reduce the vision further. Right eye definitely needs a cyclophotocoagulation.
Further, okay.
Correct.
And there was one question in the chat box. I'm sorry to intervene, Abhilash. One question in the chat box regarding Murali's talk is that whether the other machine you mentioned, that is the Quantel one,
yeah,
does that also have this 90-minute probe? And you know,
no, it doesn't have. I've taken a demo of that machine.
Okay.
I have a demo of that machine. It is a different kind of a probe. It's not called MP3. It is not called micropulse because micropulse is a trademark.
You can't use the word micropulse. Okay.
So they call it some suboptima, subliminal, some other name is there for that. So you can't use the cyclo-G6, you can't use the micropulse term for that. It's a trademark issue.
Okay.
Yeah, so you can't do that. And it is the same laser. If you have the same duty cycle and you can deliver it, there is one institution and a couple of other doctors whom I know are using that machine. I think Jipmer has it. Jipmer has bought this version of the micropulse laser and they are using it for retinal application also, I think. So it can also be used for retinal application. It does not have the 90-minute duration. And unfortunately, I saw this machine after I bought my machine. So I didn't have a choice. So I only could take a demo and give a honest feedback. But I regretfully say that if somebody has a choice of trying out both,
you we try saw out it in Lucknow GSI, I think.
I know. So you take a honest evaluation, take a demo of both, and then you decide what suits you best.
Sorry for that intervention, Abhilash. You can go ahead with your cases. How many more you have? One more? Two more?
Sorry, you're muted, sir. Abhilash, sir.
We have four more cases, actually.
So I think we can quickly go through them.
Yeah, okay. No more comments on this case, NDG 19. I think it's been covered. We'll go ahead to the next. So here's our 67-year-old gentleman who had come for a routine checkup. He's been a hypertensive for the past 7 years. The best correct visual acuity is 612 and 6 in the right eye, 618 and 6 in the left eye. He's having cortical cataract and gonioscopy shows open angles up to the pleural sphere in both eyes. Intraocular pressure is in the right eye 23 and left eye 33. Disc findings are normal. So you have normal appearing disc, the NRR appears healthy, the RNFL is also healthy. Fields are normal, and so is the OCT. The corneal thickness is 513 in the right eye and 510 in the left eye. So we have a patient who has come for routine checkup. We find that the intraocular pressure is high, cornea is borderline thin, maybe, and IOP is high. Probably an ocular hypertension patient. Now, on what would you base your decision to whether start treatment or whether to withhold, whether to, you know, follow up? Sir, I think we'll start.
Murli, I think you can speak because I think Devan is having some connectivity issue.
Yeah, I think, see here, basically you don't have a problem. The patient is apparently normal. There is no glaucoma. The pressure is okay statistically on the higher side. You have an open angle and there is no issue really. And even if you look at the so-called five-year risk of this particular patient developing glaucoma as far as corneal thickness or intraocular pressure is concerned, I would probably just observe the patient unless you have a strong family history. Suppose you have a family history or you have pseudo-exfoliation or you have some other something like an angle closure situation. I would probably observe this patient and counsel the patient that you're having a statistically higher pressure than what is there in the general population, but your pressure is not too high. In an ocular hypertension situation, I would generally treat everybody with more than 30. Everybody who is between, say, 26 to 28, I would discuss and decide to treat on a case-to-case basis. Between 24 and 26, I generally observe. I don't usually treat unless there's a family history or some other secondary factor is there. 23, 24, everything looking good. I would say you are at the higher limit of the statistical population, so-called intraocular pressure. I would simply watch you, but remember that your pressure is on the higher side. Keep coming back at least a couple of times in, say, once or twice a year, or at least annually. Keep watching the intraocular pressure and looking at the disc and the RNFL. More than the field, I would pay more attention to the disc and the RNFL. That's something like an OCT rather than doing the field. Field you will expect will be normal for quite some time.
So you would probably look
for... Only you can switch on your video. Since you don't have a presentation. Thank you. Any other comments?
I think it's probably better to be less aggressive as far as ocular hypertension is concerned because we find that many, many people have the so-called borderline pressures and so-called statistically higher pressures. And we will be doing a serious injustice to all of our patients. If you start treating everything more than 21 with normal disc and normal field, you would probably be treating about 10% of the population. So it's probably be better because glaucoma is not a disease which is going to cause blindness in 1 year or 2 years. So you can actually afford to sort of not treat people who are in the borderline between 22 and 24. And anything over 30 is a family history or 30 and 28 is a definite indication for treating ocular hypertension.
And I think once you have pseudo exfoliation, I think technically we shouldn't be calling it an ocular
hypertension. Primary glaucoma. Absolutely.
That's a slightly more dangerous variety of glaucoma. Yeah.
if you do start treatment, would you still start with prostaglandins, or would you maybe start with some other?
That's a good question.
A very good question. I think my choice, actually, I didn't want to bring that up. Actually, what I would usually do is, most people with this kind of situation don't want to be treated with drops daily, and their compliance is generally not good. But there is no drive to use medication for these kind of patients. And invariably, the ocular surface and compliance becomes a problem. So I would offer SLT to all these patients.
So that's,
this is the ideal. You have ocular hypertension, you want to bring down the pressure, and you don't want the patient to probably keep using medication. SLT is my first drug of choice for the so-called, whenever I want to treat ocular hypertension.
Yeah, that is another way of looking at it, although many may not have access to it.
Correct.
Yeah, so definitely that is, that's, you know, another way of treating. If it is a drug, what would be your first choice?
Prostaglandin. Again, they are, I think we have the... what you call as the ultimate weapon in ophthalmology in glaucoma is the prostaglandin. You don't have anything better. If you can't use a prostaglandin for some reason, then you look at alternatives. The first choice drug is most often a prostaglandin. And prostaglandins, I don't really think, unless there's some pharma company pushing you, say Monday will be bimetoprost, Tuesday will be travertine, something like that. There's no real choice between the drugs. All three work the same.
But in ocular hypertensives with the normal disc and all, where your treatment itself is plus minus, I don't know. I would rather err on the side of a CA inhibitor, maybe in combination with a beta blocker, because the local side effects in a long term is definitely a matter of
the
concern.
With
prostaglandin. So in these sort of situations, nowadays I am using more of bimetoprost alone, or bimetoprost or dorzolamide in combination with a beta blocker, because of the sheer number of long term all this periorbitopathies that we see, you know, patients.
I tell my fellows
those who are on bimetoprost, I can spot from the corridor, other end of the corridor,
security guard can tell you, sir, glaucoma patient is coming. So
So in a real bad glaucoma with an advanced field defect and, you know, things like that, then you are not left with any choice other than prostaglandins, obviously, and the angle closures that we mentioned. But these sort of plus minus situations, somehow my personal choice is slightly different. Any other comments, Manoj, Arun?
Dr. Manoj, anything?
How many of you do SLT here?
Yeah, Abhilash has, we have got MLT.
We have MLT.
Yeah. Yeah, we have MLT. Abhilash does all our MLTs. Yeah, yeah.
But not very frequent.
Must confess.
About the Sai, about the, because bimetoprost, the, you know, the orbital fat
atrophy
that is,
looks really terrible sometimes.
Yeah, among the prostaglandins, I think the best tolerated is probably latanoprost.
Latanoprost.
As far as HFA works. Yeah, but the non-responder rate is somewhat high with latanoprost.
Correct.
So, striking a compromise between tolerance, efficacy, and non-responder rate, and so on. So, most of us hit upon travoprost as probably the drug which works the best, has the least hyperemia, and probably has so-called the dues, as we call it. Deepening of the upper eyelid, the prostaglandin periorbitopathy of Ganfort, and bimetoprost. So probably, I think you have to take a call on which prostaglandin is your favorite. There's no real particular preference for any prostaglandin here.
I think I'll move on.
You can go on to the next case.
So here we have a 74-year-old lady who has come with the complaints of swelling and watering and aching pain, along with the redness of the right eye of 5 months duration. She had been to other hospitals without much relief, and she finally landed up in our place. She's hypertensive since the past 2 years. Now, the correct vision is 6'9" and 6" in the right eye, that is the affected eye. On examination, there was a periocular fullness. There's no specific mass as such, but there is moderate proptosis. There's diffuse congestion, chemosis, and dilated epithelial vessels with Cox growing. There is nucleus pellucidosis as well as cortical cataract. The gonioscopy is open up to the pleural spur. The intraocular pressure is 27 millimeters of mercury. And disc is congested with ill-defined margins and tortuous vessels. Left eye, apart from nucleus sclerosis cataract, is normal. This is the photo of the lady. She's having phimosis and proptosis of the right eye. You can see the obstructed vessels in the photos. This is a full fundus photo. Unfortunately, I don't have a disc photo. But the right eye shows ill-defined disc margins along with tortuous vessels compared to the left eye. Pales are apparently normal. Patient did undergo MRI. She had indirect CCF and underwent embolization, and the symptoms did resolve. But some of these patients who present with very high spontaneous pressure rises because of indirect CCF. So what do we do to control such pressure rise? Sometimes they do present in a rather acute fashion.
Yeah, correct. So I think definitely you have to hear the patients, as you already dealt with the low flow CCF for the so-called reason for the raised epistolary venous pressure. Obviously, you're dealing with the secondary glaucoma, the raised epistolary venous pressure, and the pressure is high, and you're also having some disc and disc changes related to the increased vascularity and so on. So prostaglandin would not be a great choice, but you can actually, because the patient's comfort and congestion, probably put on a little bit of a topical steroid for comfort and lubricant again for comfort, and consider one drug at a time. I would probably start off with maybe timolol, see how the drug works, and then also consider a prostaglandin is not contraindicated, but you can use a prostaglandin also, but I would probably here consider timolol first and see there, because the disc doesn't look very bad. The field also doesn't look like it's gone in for a severe glaucomatous change. So wait and see the response to medical treatment, see how the response to the CCF has been. And then maybe a little while, think of a surgical option.
How do these eyes behave post-closure of the, post-embolization? Do they really come back to normal as far as the glaucoma is concerned, or do we really need to follow them up on a long term?
See, the so-called, we see quite a bit of the idiopathic epistolary venous pressures, and those relate, we don't really know what the reason is. They say low flow, which can't be picked up by an interventional radiologist and so on. So those patients invariably end up with a mitomycin trab, and many of them do well. Many of them do well, but the pressure stabilizes, but they still remain red and they keep coming back. The glaucomas don't progress, they probably end up with at least one drug post-TRAB also. But some of them don't do well, and they, despite everything, they keep progressing, end up with a tube and cataract surgery and so on. But I think this kind of patient, I think will probably do well with medical treatment initially and may end up with a mitomycin TRAB is my feeling.
Probably we should go for combined surgery later on.
A combined surgery will be actually, there's a small risk of having an intraoperative bleed or something like that because of vascularity. So better to take it one step at a time. Unless there's a significant cataract, probably deal with the pressure first as a priority. Look at the cataract as a additional step or a second procedure.
So do they have a higher risk of getting non-papillary block angle closure?
Correct. So I think surgery has to be done with caution only. Try medical treatment. If you think it's getting worse, starts to show cupping and so on, don't hesitate to operate. You can do a mitomycin trab. Mitomycin trab does work well. And keep the option of a tube also in mind.
Gopal, what is our time limit? Discussion will go on like that. I think Murali...
Time limit is your time. I think
Murali is our star now. I think till 9:30, is it okay, Murali?
No problem at all.
Yeah.
Up to you. You have a couple of more situations. I think all are very interesting. Abhilash, I think you have done a great job putting in, getting the data.
Abhilash has really done a great job.
Despite all your busy schedule, you're able to manage to get out all these case records.
I think two more we'll have, Abhilash.
Yes, sir. Sure.
Yeah.
So we have a 38-year-old male patient who was actually referred for YAG-BI. He had complaints of decrease in vision and pain in both eyes 2 years previously. He was treated initially with TAP Diamox and Timolol eye drops. And when he presented to our hospital, he was already on these two medications past 2 days. So his vision was counting fingers 3 meters, which had improved to 6.9 with minus 4 diopter here in both eyes and N6 near vision. Anterior chamber showed shallow anterior chambers with sluggish pupil. There was appositional closure on gonioscopy, and the intraocular pressure was 30 in the right eye and 26 in left eye. The disc was normal. So, prima facie, it's PAC. However, these are the photos. We did a UBM also, the slit lamp photo, which shows almost the iris coming in contact with the cornea. Because this patient had myopia and very shallow AC, and the patient was not having any refractive error a few weeks prior to presentation, we asked instead of drug intake, and he did have drug intake for headache 2 weeks prior, and that's why we did the UBM. So UBM is showing supraparotid effusion as well as shallow anterior chamber. So we made a diagnosis of secondary drug-induced anticlosure. Patient was having topiramate for migraine. So we stopped the topiramate, and this was how the patient reacted. After a few weeks, we could find the anterior chamber opening up as well as the UBM as showed resolution of the supraparotid effusion. So how often do you find these sort of patients, drug-induced anticlosure glaucoma, and what really makes you suspect that the patient may be having non-pupillary anticlosure?
Yeah, I think bilateral angle closure with this kind of a situation suddenly presenting with very high pressures and a typical bilateral angle closure. So it's unlikely to be a primary pupillary block mechanism angle closure suddenly appearing in both eyes. It's uncommon to have a primary pupillary block mechanism. So you can suspect, and like you have rightly done, ask for a history of drugs. There are so many drugs implicated in this bilateral angle closure. And many people have prescriptions of 5 or 6 drugs, many comorbid illnesses, psychiatric illnesses, all kinds of drugs are implicated, including Diamox. Even acetazolamide has been implicated in the causation of bilateral angle closure. So what you must all realize in the audience in the session here today is that it is not a pupillary block mechanism. So you are not going to benefit, and the patient is not going to benefit by doing a YAG laser iridotomy. So don't be in a hurry to go and do a YAG PA in this patient. Try to control the pressure to the extent possible, to the medically extent feasible. Maybe give a little mannitol, little probably acetazolamide, some medication to reduce the like something like brimonidine timolol combination. Here, a combination you can start off straight away. Brimonidine timolol, dorzolamide timolol, any kind of drug which will lower the intraocular pressure, short bolus of even mannitol you can consider. And don't forget to apply a little topical steroid. A steroid will actually help to control the inflammation and make the patient comfortable. And even you can actually use cycloplegic. Maybe look at homatropine or look at some other drug to make the ciliary body go back. It's basically a ciliocoroidal effusion, and the UBM will show you that picture. You simply have to wait on it and don't treat it with a YAG-PI. And the offending agent has to be obviously stopped. You need to discuss with the treating physician that you are stopping the drug, whatever the drug the patient has been using. Document it well. And sometimes we find patients present very late. One eye would be invariably become no PL or very, very high pressures and so on. I see that very often. Whenever they come to me, invariably end up with one eye query PL, no PL. Other eye will be in like 636, 624 vision, and the pressures are just start becoming pale. So when the intraocular pressure rises slowly in a glaucoma patient, you will start seeing the typical cupping and RNFL defects and field loss and so on. When the pressure rises acutely like this to 50 and 60 and so on in a short time, it will be almost like an ischemic optic neuropathy in which the disc becomes pale. You will not see the typical glaucomatous kind of disc changes.
So that is why you can expect that the disc pallor you can start seeing earlier than you can see in the other chronic glaucomas. So it will be quite atypical as far as disc findings, atypical as far as gonioscopy and UBM is concerned. And the recognition is very, very important.
So I think there is no point in giving pilocarpine because many people jump to the
conclusion. Absolutely no need to do pilocarpine. Mm-hmm. Pilocarpine is not going to help in any way. Yeah.
I think one or two interesting anecdotes I would like to share regarding this particular topic. This was way back in, I think, 2005 or 6 when a patient, even before I think Abhilash joined us, a patient presented like this, and literature about topiramate-induced, AC shallowing and acute liver just coming in. I don't remember the year. I think it's 2005, and there was a patient whom we thought it was bilateral angle closure, started the patient on pilocarpine. We were actually prepared to do a PI. And then something amiss we found out and started digging up the literature and found out that there is an entity like this. I am frankly, I was hearing about this particular entity for the first time. And then we decided not to go ahead with the PI. And at that particular patient, actually, we gave systemic steroids for resolution, and the patient ultimately did well. That is the first incident that I thought I'll share. The second thing is we have also published with Dr. Mahesh, we have published a few cases where you have drug-induced myopia alone without angle closure. So just myopia, I think it was, I forgot the drug. So drug-induced myopia without much of angle closure and intraocular pressure rise. So presumably due to the same mechanism. And the third incident was an ENT surgeon very close to us who started some medication for decongestion or something for a young lady. And the lady developed sudden decrease in vision, came to our hospital. Somebody saw in the casualty and said it is probably due to the drug. They went back to the ENT surgeon, with some 40, 50 people and, told him that your drug has created blindness for a young lady and things like that. There was a big issue in that ENT hospital and all. So I think now I think the present day, even postgraduates, youngsters, everyone is aware of a condition like this. And, when you get your antennas are up. But this was not the scenario about 15 years back. I think it was 2005 or 6. I really don't remember.
Correct. The literature started coming about 15 years ago. Absolutely right. Yeah. And that time we don't have the Google search. We don't have
nothing,
our phones
nothing.
To search
we didn't
for
know
data.
What was happening.
Yeah.
We didn't know
you
what
ask your
happening.
PG a question, a fellow a question. You turn back and see they're all on their phones and give you an answer before you finish the question. So you have your Google search for you. And I think now this has actually come down to the other opposite situation in whom we get reference from neurologists saying that this patient has migraine. I am going to start topiramate. Please evaluate and tell me, will this patient develop angle closure or not?
How do we do that?
Is there a predictive value of glaucoma specialist in telling you? So I say it's idiosyncratic. Nobody can predict. He says, no, I have sent it to you anyway. If anything happens, you are responsible. So it's the other way around. It turns the table on you. Yeah. So you have to be careful that you will start getting referrals from neurologists saying that you evaluate for glaucoma before I start the drug.
I think
Abhilash, one more last case and then we can wind up. Yeah.
So my last case for the day is a 48-year-old male who has presented with decreased vision, pain and colorful halos around the light of the left eye, 3 days duration. He's been having similar episodes in the past, was being treated individually elsewhere. And he has a vision of 6-6 and 6 in both eyes. And on examination, the intraocular pressure is right eye 15 and left eye 42. So in the left eye, there is a diffuse ciliary congestion, microcystic edema is there, sluggish pupil reaction. There's grade 1 flare and a few scattered KPs. Actually, initially it was not noted, it was only the second visit. Gonioscopy was opened, intraocular pressure 42, and there's not much of flare, only a few KPs that we could find out. left eye. This is the second visit that we could take the photo. But anyway, the case is, he had subsequent episodes of similar complaints, and he turned out to be Mantle positive. So this is glaucoma due to inflammation. And in steroids, we do have to start because of the inflammation. Medications, what should you prefer? Definitely, prostaglandins probably are ruled out, and timolol or any other medication which you would like to start.
Yeah, I think definitely you have an inflammatory glaucoma here, and angle is apparently so-called open, at least. I think you are muted, I think.
Angles are open.
Yeah, here you're dealing with uveitis-related raised intraocular pressure. Treat the uveitis. Primary disease is uveitis. So you need to treat the uveitis to the best manner possible. And a positive MANTO does not mean that the patient has tuberculous uveitis, because MANTO positive is very common in our population. So actually, you need to get it evaluated properly to look at other possible causes for uveitis, and including a possibility of a viral uveitis and so on. Keep that in mind. Have a good evaluation. Since we have the luxury of having other colleagues who deal with uveitis, have a good workup done so that you can look at the etiology for the uveitis. Treat the uveitis, control the intraocular pressure. I would probably straight away start with brimonidin timolol. That's my favorite as far as this kind of glaucoma is, IOP is concerned. You wouldn't really call it a glaucoma because you don't really know the disc and the field here. It's something like a secondary ocular hypertension, like picture with the intraocular pressure is high. So you would probably treat the pressure with a combination of, well, pressure is 40. You're not going to be expecting a lowering of the pressure with one drug like timolol. So add brimonidin, or if your favorite is some other drug, start up with a combination, maybe put in a little of Diamox to reduce the intraocular pressure. In parallel, treat the uveitis also.
And the role of topical steroids, you know, has to be really stressed where this one condition where steroids
primarily reduce. Primarily, it's not a glaucoma. Primarily, it's a uveitis. So that is the
primary treatment. Yeah. Okay, so if there are no more comments, we will come to the end of the program. We had a real great evening. Thanks to Murli. Devan was with us for some time. I think he had some issues. Probably because he was in a physical meeting. So, and Abhilash, thank you very much for compiling all these cases and, you know, presenting.
I think a wonderful compilation. I think you're really given us a gamut of whatever we see. Running our OP in the evening at home.
It is like seeing a variety of, you know, cases. So I request Dr. Thomas Arun Varghese, our scientific committee chairman, to formally thank the speakers and the sponsors.
Good evening, everyone. Big thanks to Dr. Murli Ariga for that excellent talk on micropulse diode laser. And I think more and more we are much more enlightened about the options and the situations where we can use it. And I think more of us will be considering purchasing one and using it. Also, big thanks to Dr. Devan Tooley, who was actually in a physical meeting at Delhi and gave us valuable comments on the cases presented. Big thanks to Dr. Abhilash for the wonderful collection of cases, really covered the whole different range of glaucoma situations that we face, and also the dilemmas. I thank the panel, Dr. Sai Kumar, Dr. Manoj Pratapan, Dr. Devan Tooley, and Dr. Murli Ariga for their wonderful comments on what are the options that we have and how they go about making their decisions on the choice of drug and management of the patients. Was a big thank for Dr. Gopal for arranging this meeting, and Dr. Murli Ariga for our meeting, and also all those who attended the meeting both on Zoom and on YouTube. A big thanks, and hope it will help us all in making our decisions in the day-to-day practice of performance. Thank you very much.
I think you can thank Allergan for
sponsoring the meeting.
Thank you, Gopal. Before we wind up, can we have the final YouTube numbers?
It's about 250 people.
Yeah.
There's a monthly meeting.
No, it's a good number for a monthly meeting. And since it is there on YouTube, within a week, it should definitely cross 500.
Amazing, amazing, Sai, and amazing, Gopal, and your team is really amazing. Wonderful to have so much of attendance despite so many.